I want to speak this morning on a message I've entitled Old Fashioned Pure Religion. There's some things that really just don't change. We don't use that word a lot in our vocabulary. If we do, it's normally negatively, like somebody says, well, they claim to be religious. Religion is a word that is used in two different forms in the New Testament. In verses 26 and 27, you find the word listed three times, but it's two different forms, two different words in the language of the New Testament. One of the words really speaks in a good light, and the other is negatively. You can be religious in just about anything you do. I brush my teeth religiously. Aren't you grateful? And I comb my hair religiously. But the bottom line is, it's just ritual, some things that you do. And so this is really sort of like a test. You can take two verses, and it's really a test that tells whether, listen to this, whether you're the real deal or not. You see, when someone hears me preach and have never met me before, they may say something like this. Wonder what he's like out of the pulpit, or is he really live what he preaches? Is he real? And they could say the same thing about a singer, a Sunday school teacher, or just someone that professes to know Christ and comes religiously, regularly, to First Baptist Church Woodstock. But James, remember, is so practical. He gets down to where the rubber meets the road, and he just says, I'm going to give you a little acid test as to whether this person's religion is the real deal or not. James 1, verse 26, stand with me in honor of the reading of God's word. If anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is useless. I don't know about you, but gosh, I don't want that said of me at the end of my life. You know, Johnny, what you did was just outward form, and it was just useless. And then he says, but pure and undefiled religion. Now he moves into the good type religion. Before God, or in the sight of God, or the type that God accepts and the Father, is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble, affliction, pressure, and while you do it, you keep oneself unspotted by the world, unsullied. It's a word that means the world has filth that it will attempt to spill on you to taint the purity that God desires in your life. Father, in the name of Jesus, speak to us. For Christ's sake, amen. You may be seated. In this chapter, James' teaching is an expansion of what he's already presented. Three times already, James has mentioned the danger of being deceived. He mentions it in verse 16, 22, and 26. As a student of my Bible, I'm the type that when I'm reading a passage or a chapter, and when I'm going to preach through a book, I read through it dozens and dozens of times, underlining words I want to make sure I have clarity on, circling words in particular that are repeated. So here I am three times, and I'm just closing chapter 1, and there's only 27 verses, and three times he talks about the possibility of being deceived. He's saying it's possible to think you're living the Christian life when in actuality, you're just fooling yourself. James has referred to the Bible as a mirror. And here one goes to the mirror to see a reflection of pure religion, and there he finds it. And James, as we've already seen, is an intensely practical Christian. He reduces everything into terms of practical daily life. So remember, he is a creative doer. He did not come to audit the course just to be a hearer, but to take the test. And his thoughts are on the day of graduation. The word religion, as I mentioned, is used three times in those two verses in two forms. Paul used this word to refer to what he was before he became a Christian. I need to make sure you heard what I just said. Paul used this word to define what he was before he became a Christian. In Acts chapter 26 and verse 5, he was speaking of his former life before he was converted. He was saying, I was an outwardly religious person. Where I've traveled in the last few days, two of the countries in particular are listed as two of the most hostile countries in the world toward Christianity. They are people there dying in the Christian church. They're being martyred, and they're being martyred by religious people, just like Saul of Tarsus was a Jew living in strict allegiance to Judaism, and he was consenting to the death of Christians and all the while thinking he was doing the will of God. Josephus, writing in the early centuries as a church historian, a Jewish man, used the word religion to describe the worship in the temple at Jerusalem. By contrast, the word most commonly used in the New Testament, which is used in verse 27, is the word Eusebia. And this word speaks of genuine, God-honoring, God-pleasing worship. The basic meaning of the word Eusebius is godliness and holiness. And so there is a religion, if we could really define it. The lost world sees it and they say this. They don't know really what to say about you, whether you're born again or you're saved or you've converted. But they'll say something like this. Yes, my neighbors are very religious. And they may be defining that in the sense that come the Lord's day, while they're just getting up, they see you pulling out of the driveway on your way to the house of God religiously. And they say they're religious. And then when somebody really gets to know someone closely, they may even go so far to say, I'll tell you one thing. If there's a real Christian out there, he or she is one of them. They're the real deal. They're godly people. I've seen them under the microscope of character testing, and they've passed the test. So this passage has been referred to as the test of true religion. It tests you in the area of conversation, how you talk, compassion, how you act, and conduct, how you live. Talking, acting, and doing. James is saying that a true believer will control his tongue, he will care for those who are oppressed and afflicted, and he will live an unspotted or unspoiled life. So this passage calls for the kind of life that God accepts. So I'm going to use three words to sort of hinge my thoughts on this morning, and we're going to serve as a test. So up in the balcony, in the choir and orchestra, all of you sitting out here in front of me on the sides, I want you to listen. I want you to listen carefully. We're going to take a little test this morning, and maybe when you leave here or not, you'll be able to look within without deception and say, I am or I am not the real deal. So first of all, let me talk about religion of the unbridled tongue. Verse 26, James is reminding us that the tongue is quite an indicator of a person's life. Matthew 12:34, Jesus said, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. This tongue says what this heart is. Matthew 12:37, Jesus said, for by your words you will be justified, or by your words you will be condemned. James in chapter 3 and verse 2 said, for we all stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says in word, he's a mature man, perfect, also able to bridle the whole body. So remember, please, we are here dealing not with regeneration. This text is not dealing with salvation as much as with religion in its practical issue. James would have us to grasp the fact that this letter consists not in what we believe, the theology, but in how we behave, practicality, fleshing out what we have come to learn in the context of our study of God. So authentic religion is much more than outward expressions of worship. Outward rituals can take place, but our hearts can still be far from God. Jesus said in Matthew 15:8, these people draw near to me with their mouth, honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. So James 1:26 describes a person who's been playing the part of one who is religious and has convinced himself that he really is religious, but in doing so, James says he's deceived himself. So the self-deceived person is one whose religious acts do not make a difference in the way he lives. I've got to repeat that. Did you hear what I just said? The self-deceived person is one whose religious acts do not make a difference in the way they live. They may be the leading singer. They may be the leading teacher. It may be a preacher, your preacher. It could be. And they're deceiving themselves, and they're going through the ritual of religious acts, but what they claim to have does not make a difference in their life. He says this, if anyone among you thinks he's religious, that means if you are of the opinion, I'm a religious person in the context that I am a godly person and my character is that of holiness. He says, but he does not bridle his tongue, and that word means to lead by a bridle. It means to hold your tongue in check, to restrain. God knows all of us at some time. Well, let me just say, I know it's true of my life. There's been times I wish to God I had bridled my tongue. And I paid dearly later, confessed, and got right with God for saying something I wish I'd not said. So he's not talking about the fact that he's already acknowledged in chapter 3 and verse 2 that all of us will stumble every now and then. But when he talks about a person that doesn't bridle his tongue, he uses a present tense verb that means habitually. If you're ever around them, it's like you've just got to put up with all of this garbage. I mean, it's just amazing. It's just habitual lifestyle of just being critical, negative, hateful. He said this person thinks they're religious. It may be their opinion. He refers to a tongue that's out of control, and it suggests a bogus religious devotion. And then he makes this statement, and this is a defining statement. This man's religion is useless. Let me define this word. This man's religion is useless. This troubles me. Four words I use to define it, because they're all synonyms. Lifeless. Means you've come, Jesus said, I've come that you might have life, and you have it more abundantly. But the religion he talks about is lifeless. It's religion versus relationship. They don't have a relationship with God. The next word really wraps it up, and that is I used the word he used, the word useless. And the word useless translates empty and that there's nothing to draw from. Now, listen to me carefully. I'm not going to assume this happens, but I think it happens. Some people come to church. They may bring their Bible. They may not. But some that bring them will leave here today, and they'll lay them somewhere where it's easy to find for next week, maybe in the back window of the car or somewhere at the house, and that won't be opened again. And all week, there's such futility in their life because they go through the rituals and they've got a religion, but it's useless. But when the Bible uses the word useless and it says empty in that there's nothing to draw from, if you've got a relationship with Almighty God, you'll read the Bible and you'll draw from the rich resources of God's word. And then tomorrow when you run into temptation, you'll face that temptation by drawing from what God has placed in you. And I'm telling you, your relationship with God is anything but useless. It is so meaningful. Oh, good night, are y'all listening? I've got somebody inside of me. I don't have this useless religion. I've got a relationship with a God that I can get hold of and share my fears, and I can draw on the resources of Almighty God. And so I feel for you. I mean, if yours is useless. Another word that refers to this useless, it means fruitless. Let me just, you just read it on your own, but read Matthew 12, 33 through 37. The Apostle Peter got it, the old fisherman, once he was saved. The last book the Spirit of God allowed him to pen was 2 Peter 1. In verse 8 he said, and if these things are yours and abound. And what things is he referring to? He's referring to 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4, where the Bible says when you become a Christian, get in relationship with God, one of the things God does, God places his nature in you. Now think about that. Where I used to not like to go to church, why do I like to go to church now? Is it because I'm religious? No, I have a relationship with God. And when I trusted Jesus Christ on January 7th, 1973, on that snowy Sunday night, what happened is God stepped out of heaven, stepped into my life. And the reason I like to go to church is he lives in me and his nature is dominant in me. And you may not believe this, but he likes to go to church. So he got me up to bring him this morning. There's another word that this useless translates as a synonym. It's the word worthless. That means empty, useless. Vain religion cannot bring a person to the goal God intended. And by the way, I can tell you what God's perfect will is for every person in this room. Romans 8:29. It's God's perfect will for every Christian that you be conformed to the image of God's dear Son. So the tongue is not the only indicator of true spirituality, but it's one of the most reliable. I read this week that up to 1/5 of the average person's life is spent talking. I wrote this one statement. It really just kind of came and I wrote it down. Listen to this. If the tongue is not controlled by God's Holy Spirit, it is a sure indicator that the heart is not controlled by God's Holy Spirit. Let me give you a second thought. Let me talk to you about the religion of the undefiled type. And this, we're getting ready to get the rubber to the road. Here it is. Verse 27 says, pure and undefiled religion before God the Father is this, that is in the sight of God, that which God accepts, that you visit the orphans and the widows in their trouble. Here's, the song says it this way, we're blessed to be a blessing. James is not referring to what's best for us, what's best for the world, what's best for the church, but he's referring to what's best before God and in the sight of God. What would God be pleased with? This morning, in the sense of worship, what will God accept from our worship? He says it's pure and it's undefiled. That speaks of cleanliness and it speaks of free of contamination. God's standard versus man's own man-made tradition. This passage speaks of, and some people get uncomfortable with this, divine obligation. I've taught it for years in theology, and that is, the Christian life does have its demands. The cross does have responsibilities. But not pulling upon your resources, but the resources God gives you. So he's actually in this test calling me to a time of divine obligation. Now, I'm getting ready to make a rather bold statement. Here it is. Have you heard us preachers through the past say this? Listen to such a narrow statement, but it's a true statement. In this room this morning, several thousand people, but really only two types. Everyone in here, Josh, is lost or saved. Everyone in here is a heartbeat from heaven or hell. But I'm gonna go a step further. Everyone in here is either ritually, outwardly religious, or in the process, God growing you into a godly, holy man, a woman of God. Everyone in this room is going to make a choice before the sermon's over, many of you already have, as to obedient or disobedient. I'm even going to go a step further, and I'll explain in a moment. Everyone in this room, are y'all listening? And don't think you can understand what I mean by this. It's just to whet your appetite. Everyone in this room will either visit or not visit. The Bible says, if your religion is real, one of the ways, and he says this all through the Bible, Deuteronomy says it, Exodus he says it, Isaiah he says it, Jeremiah he says it, the Psalms he says it, Luke he says it, and now in James. He says, but if you've got this real religion, I mean you're the real deal before God, the type that God accepts, you visit orphans and widows in their trouble. Really? So visit is the word. It means exercising oversight on their behalf. Listen to this. It means when Jesus visited his people, he came in order to help, to strengthen, to encourage them. Luke 1:68, blessed is the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people. Luke 1:78, through the tender mercy of our God, with which the day spring from on high has visited us. Luke 7:16, then fear came upon all, and they glorified God, saying, a great prophet has arisen among us, and God has visited his people. Here's my favorite, Hebrews 2:16, he's quoting from the Psalms, but one testified in a certain place, saying, what is man that you are mindful of him? And the Son of Man, and listen to the translation in the New King James Version, that you take care of him. Jesus said, if the church is the real deal, it will take care of widows and orphans. That's pure religion, undefiled before God. So the visit means to look out for someone. You're looking out for them. It carries the connotation of being so personal, it means to select someone. It carries the idea of inspection or to visit with help. You go in and you inspect the situation and you say, how can I be involved? It speaks of pure religion that is marked by a personal ministry. Now notice it said orphans and widows in their trouble. That means in their affliction. Why would he say them? Because such people as widows and orphans are, first of all, parents. They're without parents. Orphans are without parents, or they're in an abused, in our nation, abused or hostile situation or neglectful situation. And then they're those that are without husbands, the widows. And many times, especially in the days of the writing of God's word, they became almost like the outcast unless the body of Christ took care of them. They couldn't take care of themselves. This is a group of people that the Bible says one of the ways we know whether what you're doing is really real and true religion or not is the people you're going to be helping are unable to reciprocate in any way. Have you ever heard somebody say this? Listen to this. I don't know about that couple. We've had them over to our house 3 times and they never have invited us to theirs. Now, like it or not, we live in the context of reciprocating. Our hearts are wicked. That's what the Bible says. And if we're not careful, our hearts always look out for number one. We're self-centered. Sometimes our attitude is, what's in this for me? But the Bible says a person that has true religion, real religion, pure religion, is you go find a little boy, a little girl. No way under heaven they can reciprocate. They can never pay you back. You go help a lady who's lost her husband, and she is in a bad way, has no way of repaying, and your caring for them reveals true sacrificial love. You're not looking for anything in return. You know they can give nothing in return. Psalm 68:5 says, a father of the fatherless, a defender of widows, is God in his holy habitation. So here's what he's saying. True Christianity is manifested by a pure and loving heart, by the way the believers talk, and by the way they act. It's manifested in how they love and care for those who are in need, not for how they love and care for those they prefer. And that's what we do. Sometimes it's not hard to find out, well, I got a cousin that's got a need, or I love that person, they got a need. But you know what? The word hospitable, you know where it comes from, hospitality? It comes from the Greek word that means loving strangers. People you've never met, Jesus is pleased because your religion is pure. You're the real deal when you can love people you've never laid eyes on. So we're always thinking who we know and who needs help. But how about those you don't know? I'm about through, but I really want to do this, and I can do it in these 5 minutes. Here it is. You remember this text? It's one of my favorite. It's found in Isaiah 1:18. Listen to it. Listen to this. Come now, God speaking. Let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they can be as white as snow. Though they be as crimson, they can be red, like wool. And so what was the context of that? He's inviting you to come and let's reason. Let's get you right and get you cleaned up. What was the context? Here was the context. Religion versus a relationship with God. I'm going to read it for you, but I want you to hear. I want to set it up for you. He used some of the strongest language in the Old Testament to say, I am so fed up with the way you do church at the temple. It's time that you start doing something practical if you have a real relationship with God. You determine. Listen to this. Isaiah 1:11. Read it on the screens. Here it is. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices to me, says the Lord? I've had enough of your burnt offerings of rams and the fat of the fed cattle. I don't delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or goats. When you come to appear before me, who has required from you your hand to trample my courts? Bring no more futile, empty sacrifices. Incense is an abomination. That means your prayers. The new moons, the Sabbath, the calling of the assemblies. Let me translate that. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. It's your special days of worship. I cannot endure iniquity in the sacred meetings. Your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. God says, I can really just hate what y'all are doing. They're trouble to me. I'm weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hands, I'll hide my eyes from you. That means they're spreading out their hands to receive from God. Even though you make many prayers, I'll not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Wash yourself. Make yourself clean. Put away the evil from your doing from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Rebuke the oppressor. And listen to what he says. Defend the fatherless and plead for the widow. And then he says, come now, let us reason together. You want a real religion? I told you I hate what you've been doing. You're just going through the motions. It's nothing that can meet your need on Monday. Get the real deal and display the real deal. You know, sometimes you quit giving statements because you've heard them so much, but it's time to give it again this morning. Have you heard it lately? People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Remember, I'll close with this. Here's a good place to close. Remember the story where Jesus said, I was hungry, you fed me. Naked, you gave me a pair of pants and a shirt. In prison, you came and visited me. You really cared about me. Sick, and you visited me. And that's Matthew 25. Now listen carefully, I'm closing. He used the word visit twice. He used it for those who did. This is good. He used it for those who did visit, and he used it for those who didn't visit. He used it for those who did care for widows and orphans, and he used it for those who didn't care. Listen to it. I wrote it down. Here it is. Verse 20. I mean, chapter 25, verse 36. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. And then verse 43. It's the only other time Jesus spoke the word visited in this context. I was a stranger. You did not take me in. Naked. You did not clothe me. Sick and in prison. And you did not visit me. And you know what question they ask is this. When did we not do that? And then Jesus said, as often as you do it, don't miss this word right here. Don't miss this word. Unto the least. Underline that in your Bible. Circle it. The least of these. You did it, not for me. You did it. Talk to me. I can't hear you. I still can't hear you. To me. Father, in Jesus' name. It's one thing just to preach, so we'll know. It's another thing to preach, hoping we'll do. And I'm preaching this morning, hoping that what we have is the real deal. Not just one that goes through the motions and never does anything, but one that is actually inside of me, attached to everything and every fiber of my being, that creates within me a holy obedience. God, draw us to obedience this morning. For Jesus' sake, amen.
الكتاب المقدس كلمة الله قادر على تغيير حياتك. تعرف الحق والحق يحررك. اطلب نسختك المجانية الآن. تشاهدون بعد قليل أيمن كفروني وحلقة من برنامج قد أكمل.
What in the world makes us so embarrassed about the gospel? So I determine to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified.
قوة الكلمة، إعلان الحق الكتابي. جون مكآرثر يقدم لنا غذاء روحيا من كلمة الله في برنامج نعمة لكم، كل يوم جمعة وسبت على قناة الملكوت.
مرة جديدة عم رحب فيكم بحلقة من برنامج قد أكمل. هالبرنامج اللي صار لكم فترة عم تشوفوا حلقاته ومستغربين ليش بهذا التوقيت أنا عم بقعد أحضر هيك حلقة، ليش الله عم يسمح أنه بهذا التوقيت أقعد أحضر هيك برنامج. توقيت الله ما حدا بيقدر يعرفه. يمكن صار لك سنين بتسمع مرات لما بتروح على الكنيسة مقاطع من الإنجيل، أو يمكن صار لك فترة حاطت الإنجيل تحت المخدة ومفكر أنه الإنجيل رح يحميك. الإنجيل كورق، ورق مثله مثل أي كتاب، لا بيحميك ولا بيقدم لك أي حماية، وإذا تركته تحت المخدة ما رح يغير لك شيء، وإذا حطيته حد التخت بينتلي غبرة والغبرة بتاكله ما بيغير فيك شيء. ما بتصير كلمة الله بالنسبة لك حية إلا يوم اللي بتفتح الإنجيل وتبلش تقرأ. شو قلو معنى الإنجيل إذا موجود عندك بالبيت وما بتفتحه؟ بعدين كيف تقدر تقول إنك بتحب الله وما بتحب كلمته، ما بتقعد بتقرأ فيها؟ أنا ماني موجود هون لا حتى دينك ولا لحتى حط عبء فوق ظهرك، بس أنا موجود هون لحتى أحكي كلمة الحق. يوم اللي أنا كنت ضايع كان الإنجيل بعيد عني، كنت أكتر شيء استعمل الإنجيل لما بدي أحلف فيه على الكذب. كتير مرات كنت أحلف بالإنجيل على الكذب لأنه ما كنت أقدر قيمته حتى الناس تصدقني. كانت كلمة الله بالنسبة لي مثل أي كتاب، مثل أي شيء عادي. اليوم كلمة الله صارت أغلى كنز بحياتي، صار الإنجيل أغلى كنز بحياتي. بس بتعرف شو تعلمت فيه؟ تعلمت فيه إنه الحياة مختلفة عن اللي بتشوفها. الحياة أحلى بكتير، بس بنفس الوقت الحياة فيها جدية، الحياة فيها مسؤولية. يعني لما بدي أقول لأ الله بحبه لازم أعرف حب الناس اللي حدي. كيف بقدر أقول مثل ما كنت عم رتل قبل شوي لك حبنا أنا بحبك يا الله، وما بقدر حب الإنسان اللي بشوفه؟ كيف بدي أتعلم حب الله اللي ما بشوفه والإنسان اللي حدي وبشوفه ما بعرف حبه؟ يمكن واحدة من الآيات اللي أنت ما بتعرف أنها موجودة بالإنجيل، لأني أنا ما كنت أعرف، أنا بحكيك عني ما كنت أعرف. اسمع الآية شو بتقول. بيقول نحن نحبه، عم يحكي روحنا الرسول، بيقول نحن نحبه يعني نحب الله لأنه هو أحبنا أولا. أنا ما بعرف حبه لو ما هو حبني، بس إن قال أحد إني أحب الله وأبغض أخاه فهو كاذب. مش أنا عم قلك، الكتاب عم بيقول. إذا عم قول إني أنا بحب الله وما بعرف حب خيي، ما بعرف حب جاري، وبنسأل كيف بده يصلح هالبلد، بنسأل كيف بده يتصلح الشرق الأوسط، وين الحب؟ وين المحبة؟ المحبة بشو؟ منحب بس الناس اللي منعرفهم. والرب يسوع قال أحبوا أعدائكم. كيف بدي حب الله اللي ما بشوفه ومش قادر حب الناس واللي الله خلقهم حدي؟ إن قال أحد إني أحب الله وأبغض أخاه فهو كاذب، لأن من لا يحب أخاه الذي أبصره كيف يقدر أن يحب الله الذي لم يبصره؟ بعرف أنه عم بحكي كلام أكبر مني ومنكم بكتير. أنا كمان ما بعرف حب، أوعى تفكر أني أنا عم بحكي كلام يعني أنا بقدر أعمله، ما أنا مثلك، أنا ما بعرف حب. بس كمان في بالكتاب المقدس وعود، مثل واحد ما وعد بيقول أنه رح يجي يوم الله يغير هذا القلب الحجر اللي جوايه واللي جواتك. إذا بدك جوات كل واحد منا في قلب حجر، هذا القلب الحجر ما بيعرف يحب، بيحب بنق الناس اللي بيحبهم. بس الله وعد انه يشيل هذا القلب الحجر الاناني اللي بيحب على ذوقه ويحط محله قلب لحم. هذا القلب بيعرف يحب. تيجي تخلي هذا الصلاه اليوم يكون صلاتك من خلال هالترنيمه. يوم اللي كتبت ترنيمه مش مستحيل عليك كنت عم فكر اكثر شيء عم اقول له صعب يا ربي علي يحب اللي بيعاديني، وبشعر انه ما في اغفر للي بيأذيني. كيف بدي حبهم يا رب وانت عم تطلب مني حبهم؟ بترجاك شيل هالقلب الحجر اللي جوايه واعطيني مكانه قلب يعرف يحب. الترنيمه اللي جايه بتقول مش مستحيل عليك تنزع من بين ضلوعي قلب الحجر.
مستحيل عليك تنزع من بين ضلوعي قلب الحجر وتعطيني قلب جديد ما بيعرف غير يحبك وتشفي فكر المريض من داء الخطيه داء البشر. مش مستحيل علي تنزع من بين ضلوعي قلب الحجر وتعطيني قلب جديد ما بيعرف غير يحبك وتشفي فكر المريض من داء الخطيه داء البشر. مش مستحيل مش مستحيل عليك يلي خلاصي فيك بلحظة تملي. مش مستحيل عليك انك كمان بلحظة تكمل في العمل. مش مستحيل عليك يلي خلاصي فيك بلحظة تملي. مش مستحيل عليك انك كمان بلحظة تكمل في العمل. بدي تعلمني حبك من قلبي كله ومن فكري كله ومن نفسي كله ومن عزمي كله. بدي تعلمني حبك من قلبي كله من فكري كله ومن نفسي حتى فكري يرضيك. بدي تكملني فيك حتى فكري يرضيك. وبعرف انه هيدا مش مستحيل عليك. مش مستحيل عليك تنزع من بين ضلوعي قلب الحجر وتعطيني قلب جديد ما بيعرف غيري يحبك وتشفي فكر المريض من داء الخطيه داء البشر.
هكذا قال السيد الرب: إني أجمعكم من بين الشعوب وأعطيكم قلبا واحدا وأجعل قلبا جديدا في داخلكم وأعطيكم روحا جديدا وأنزع قلب الحجر من داخلكم وأعطيكم قلب لحم لكي تسلكوا في فرائضي وتحفظوا أحكامي وتعملوا بها فأكون لكم إلها وتكونون لي شعبا.
صعب يا رب علي حب اللي بيعاديني بشعر إني ما فيي اغفر للي بيأذيني. صعب يا رب علي حب اللي بيعاديني صعب علي وبشعر إني ما فيي اغفر للي بيأذيني. يا ما بحاول سامح وانسى جروح مبارح. يا ما بحاول سامح وانسى جروح مبارح وكيف عم بقدر اقول بحبك وانا مش قادر اقبل. خيي بدي تعلمني حبك من قلبي كله من فكري كله ومن نفسي ومن عزمي كله. بدي تعلمني حبك من قلبي كله من فكري كله من نفسي كله ومن عزمي كله. بدي تكملني فيك حتى فكري يرضيك. بدي تكملني فيك حتى فكري يرضيك وبعد مستحيل عليك، مش مستحيل عليك تنزع من بين ضلوعي قلب الحجر، تعطيني قلب جديد ما بيعرف غيري يحبك، تشفي فكر المريض من داء الخطيه داء البشر.
أعظم حب وأعجب قصة حب عرفتها البشرية ظهرت على الصليب. الناس بيفكروا الصليب ضعف، الناس بيفكروا الصليب نهاية، ولكن الصليب كان هدف الله منذ الأزل. بطرس الرسول بيقول: لأنكم قد اشتريتم بثمن، لا بأشياء تفنى من فضة أو ذهب أو أي كنز من كنوز هذه العالم، بل بدم كريم كما من حمل بلا عيب، دم يسوع المسيح المعروف سابقا قبل تأسيس العالم. الصليب منه شيء فجأة فاجأوا لله، مش إنه وصل الرب يسوع المسيح والله تفاجأ بالصليب، أبدا البشرية تفاجأت بالصليب، بس الصليب كان بفكر الله من الزمان. أعظم محبة بالعالم ظهرت على الصليب. تعرفوا ليش؟ قادر تتخيل انه نفس الناس اللي شفاهم الرب يسوع المسيح هن ذاتهم كانوا واقفين قدام بيلاطس وعم يصرخوا ويقولوا اصلبه؟ قادر تتخيل انه يمكن يكون في شي واحد كان اعرج ومش قادر يمشي وساكن بأورشليم وبده مين يساعده لحتى لا يوصل لحد قصر بيلاطس، وبيوم من الايام التقى بالرب يسوع المسيح وشفاه وصار يمشي. وهيدا الاعرج هو ذاته سمع بيوم من الأيام الفريسيين عم بيقولوا عن يسوع أنه هيدا بيروح بعلى زبول أو بيروح الشيطان عم يشفي، لأنه الفريسيين كانوا يكرهوه ليسوع. فبلش يفكر وصدق، قال لك معقول هذا في شيطان؟ نسي أنه شفاه، قال لك معقول أنه هيدا يكون راح لما شافهم عم يحكموا عليه، شو بتريدوا نعمل فيه؟ صار يصرخ أصلبه، ما امبارح شفاك. يمكن يكون في واحد أخرس مش عارف يحكي ونفسه الأخرس رجع راح وقف قدام بيلاطس وقال له أصلبه. بس خليني أسأل سؤال، هل كان يسوع عارف انه هيدا الاخرس اللي رح يشفيه رح يرجع بكره بوقت من الاوقات يقول عنه اصلبه؟ نعم كان عارف. هل كان عارف انه المشلول اللي كان رح يشفيه يمكن يوقف قدام بيلاطس ويقول اصلبه؟ نعم كان عارف، بس بالرغم من كل هيدا شفاه. بالرغم من كل هيدا شفاه، ما شفاهن لانهم بيستاهلوا، شفاهن لانهم بحبهم. الرب يسوع بيقول عنه الكتاب اكثر من مره: فتحنن يسوع اذ راى الجموع كثيره كخراف منطرحة منزعجة لا راعي لها. قصة الحب العجيبة قد تجلت في الصليب. هيدي أعظم وأجمل قصة حب ظهرت بالصليب.
قصة الحب العجيب قد تجلت بالصليب، قد رواها لي حبيبي ساعة الصمت الرغيب، وهو مسحوق الفؤاد وهو مجروح الجبين، قد رواها لي حبيبي بالدم الغالي الثمين. I'm not afraid.
كل حب في كياني رده حب يسوع. إذا في حب جواتي مش من عنده، من عنده. إذا في حب بقلب أي إنسان مش من عنا، من عنده. لأن إحنا ما بنعرف نحب. الحب اللي فينا هو مثل الصدى. لما بتروح على وادي فاضي ما في شيء، توقف تنده باسمك أيمن 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 أيمن، تسمع الصدى. الحب اللي عم يطلع منا هو صدى الحب اللي هو حطه فينا. قال لي بحبك، صرت أنا أعرف أقول بحبك، بحبك. إذا ما تمتعت بحبه مش رح أعرف حب الناس. ما في أعجب من هيك محبة، ولا رح البشرية تقدر تلاقي أعظم من هيك محبة. الكتاب المقدس بيقول نحن نحبه لأنه هو أحبنا أولا. قصة الحب عجيبة كتير، عجيبة. أعجب من هيك ما بقى فيه. بيستحق إنه لما تيجي تتطلع على الصليب وتشوف اللي معلق على الصليب وتعرف إنه تعلق كرمالك، تشوف إنه اللي كان على الصليب عم بيصير كان عم بيصير لهدف واحد حتى يوصل بالآخر، والرب يسوع هو معلق على الصليب يقول قد أكمل، يعني حسابك يا أيمن اندفع. قد أكمل يعني حسابك اللي عم تشاهدني على التلفزيون اندفع. يمكن عندك أسئلة كتير وبتحب تعرف. أنا ما عندي كل الأجوبة، بس بوعدك إنه الكتاب المقدس فيه كل الأجوبة. أنا ما حدا غيرني، كلمة الله غيرتني. نصيحتي إلك بهالأيام اللي أنت عم تمر فيها، بكل الضيق اللي أنت فيه، حتى أنت وفرحان مبسوط معتبر حالك مبسوط، بيستحق الله أنك تفتح كلمته وتقراها حتى تشوف محبته لألك. لقائنا أنا وياكم بتجدد بالحلقة اللي جاية. ما تنسوا تخبروا أصحابكم أنه هذا البرنامج يمكن يغير حياتهم وتبلش عن جديد مشوار مع الرب يسوع المسيح. بشوفكم بالحلقة اللي جاية.